The human carrier of the divine revelation must be pure and untainted. The human carrier, furthermore, who is the recipient of this revelation, is completely passive and helpless to the will of God. Briefly, it is the same phenomena of divine will of kun fayakun. When he says be, then it happens. Further, were this purity of the soul not to exist, the divine word would become in a sense tainted with the human knowledge and not be presented to the mankind in its pristine purity. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was completely passive in the face of divine command and the revelation that he received from God. He added nothing to this revelation himself. He did not write a book, but conveyed the sacred book to mankind free from any interpolation or human additions. To an ordinary person, when studying the Holy Quran, there are many characteristics which seem incomprehensible from the human point of view. The Holy Quran is neither like a mystical text nor a manual of logic, although it contains both mysticism and logic. It is not poetry, although it contains most powerful poetic rhythms. The Holy Quran contains different types of chapters and verses, some which are instructional and explanatory and very long, while others which are short and to the point. It contains abundant mention of the plant life, of geometry, of symmetry, and clarity of mineral kingdom. It expresses historical facts or phenomena, but the power of the Holy Quran does not lie in the description, but in the lesson mankind can draw from it, and the symbols and moral dimensions whose meaning is valid forever, and the truth which by its very nature is perennial. Of course, the Holy Quran does mention certain facts, such as rebellions of certain people and of punishments of those people. But even these facts retain their power because they concern us as a symbol of reality, which is always with us. But the real purpose of any sacred book, as the promised Messiah says, and I quote, "The chief purpose of a book of God and a messenger of God is to save the world from a life of sin and to establish a holy relationship between God and the world. It is not their purpose to teach people subjects of secular studies or to instruct them in worldly inventions." Chashmai Ma'afat, page 292. And this purpose the Holy Quran serves abundantly. The Holy Quran actually bears many names. Al-Quran, Al-Furqan, and Al-Kitab are three of many that I will mention. The Holy Quran is first Al-Quran, namely a recitation from which its common name is derived. There is no other scripture that is recited so often and so regularly by so many people in the world every day. It is also Al-Furqan, that is a discrimination, in that it is the instrument by which human being can come to differentiate between truth and falsehood, between real and unreal, between absolute and relative, and between good and evil. Finally, Al-Kitab, as Al-Kitab, it is the book, and in that sense, the Holy Quran is the prototype of all books. Being the final word of God, the Holy Quran contains universal message. And it was necessary, as the promised Messiah points out once again, and I quote, "All the previous books beginning with Torah and ending with Gospel are addressed to a particular people, namely the children of Israel, and a state, and they state in clear words that the directions contained in them are limited to the children of Israel. But the aim of the Holy Quran is to reform the world and is not addressed or limited to any particular people. It states clearly that it has been revealed for the benefit of the whole mankind. Unquote. Kitab al-Bariya, page 85. The Holy Quran contains essentially three types of message for human beings. First, it contains doctrinal message, a set of moral and legal principles, which is the basis of Sharia and which contains the life of a human being in sufficient details and for all circumstances. It explains the nature of Godhead and the unity of God with a great force, about the nature of universe, about the final end of the human being and the hereafter. In short, it gives all the teachings and guidance necessary to explain to the human being to know who he is, where he is, and where he should be going. Secondly, the Holy Quran is like a vast book of history. It recounts the story of people, tribes, kings, prophets, and saints over the ages. Their trials and their tribulations, their reactions, their denials, their patience and their perseverance. How God punished them and rewarded them. Although couched in historical terms, the message is addressed to the human soul. Were the message to contain only a tribe that went astray centuries ago, it would not be able to attract us. But every event about every being, every tribe and every race bears an essential dimension that concerns us today. The munafiq or hypocrite who divides people and spreads falsehood concerning religions also exists within every individual today. The person who has gone astray or who follows the straight path or he who is punished by God or rewarded by him, all these actors in sacred history, as recounted in the Holy Quran, are also symbols of forces existing within every one of us today. The Holy Quran, therefore, is a commentary on a man's worldly existence. It is a book whose reading reveals to us the significance of human life, which begins with birth and ends in death. Begins from God and returns to Him. Thirdly, the Holy Quran contains a quality which is difficult to express. Call it what we may, it is a sort of magic, if you want to say that, for short of word, which cannot be described. Even the physical presence of the Holy Quran carries with it grace and barakah. When a Muslim is in difficulty, he reads certain verses of the Holy Quran to comfort himself. When he wants something or is in dire need, again he turns to appropriate verses of the Holy Quran to supplicate. Indeed, the Holy Quran is full of such prayers, each and every